My name is Simon Goto. I'm the director of CRASSH, and it's a great pleasure to welcome you all here. You know why you're here, for John Searle. We've been teaching at Berkeley for many years, history of philosophy of mind, philosophy of language, and he's been a dominant philosopher for many of us for many years. He's here visiting with the Cambridge Centre for Social Ontology, run by Tony Lawson. And he's here partly thanks to Mellon Foundation funding for the disciplinary innovation at CRASSH. So we're delighted to welcome you here. I'm going to say no more than that, and I hope you'll join me in welcoming John Searle.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Well, it's great to be here, and I want to thank the people who organize this. I can never organize anything, so I'm always amazed that somebody can. And I especially want to thank Tony Lawson, who's been a fantastic host. And I have to say, it's a great pleasure to lecture to any outfit called CRASSH. That's what I feel like I want to do. Okay, now I'm going to talk about consciousness. And it's, I think, is a desperately important subject, but it's curiously neglected. When I was an undergraduate philosophy student at the other university, nobody talked about consciousness. I mean, they sometimes brushed it aside. Ryle wrote a book about, I call it Concept of Mind, which seemed to just push it off to one side. And the situation was really no better in the sciences. When I got interested in consciousness, I thought, well, it's a biological problem like any other. Why don't these brain scientists get busy and solve it? What am I paying them to do? You know, get busy and figure out how the brain does it. So I went over to University of California at San Francisco, UCSF, and they're pretty self-confident about their scientific credentials. And I said to these famous neuroscientists, when are you guys going to solve the problem of consciousness? When are you going to figure out how the brain does it exactly? And a famous guy, some Oxford hesitation forbids me to mention his name. But anyway, a famous guy said to me, look, in my discipline, it's okay to be interested in consciousness, but get tenure first, right? Get tenure first. Now, there has been a change, and that is, I think maybe you could now get tenure by working on consciousness. I hope that's the case. Anyway, so I'm going to talk about consciousness, and I have, when I'd been doing this subject for some years, it occurred to me, what's the history behind our peculiar resistance? What's the peculiar history behind our inability to face the problem of consciousness? And it seemed to me, we're the victim of two traditions, both of which make the same mistake but think they're opposed to each other. One is the tradition of God, the soul, and immortality, and that says consciousness is not a real part of the physical world. It's not a part of biology. It's a, well, I don't have to tell you the whole story. It is, it's not a feature of the human body, certainly not the human brain. It's a feature of the soul, and as Descartes told us, God attaches the soul to the body temporarily. But don't worry, because you're going to get loose from this body. That's one tradition. Okay, now there's another tradition that thinks it's opposed to that, that it shares with it the view that consciousness is not a part of the physical world. This is a tradition of scientific materialism that says either consciousness doesn't exist at all, which is probably what they thought to be the case, or if it does, it's certainly not a suitable subject for scientific investigation. Now, I'm fighting against both of these traditions in this talk, and I'm going to start in a way that I think is crucial. Though it may sound a bit boring, I want to give a definition of consciousness. People sometimes say it's very hard to define consciousness. I don't think so. I think if you're talking about the kind of common sense definition that enables us to identify the target of the investigation, then it's rather easy. We don't have a scientific definition. The situation is a bit like this. You can define water in the usual dictionary way as a clear, colorless, tasteless liquid falls out of the sky, and then later on you discover that water is H2O. Now, with consciousness, we're still in the clear, colorless, tasteless liquid stage. I can give you that kind of a definition. Later on, we hope we'll find the neurobiological definition, and I'm going to tell you some problems with getting a neurobiology of consciousness. Anyway, here goes. It's not a very big deal definition. Consciousness consists of all of those states of feeling or sentience or awareness. It is a set of processes that begin when you wake from a dreamless sleep, and it continues all day until you go to sleep again or drop dead or go into a coma or otherwise become, as we would say, unconscious. That just points at the target. On this definition, dreams are a form of consciousness, even though they are quite different from normal waking consciousness. So that's what we're trying to analyze. What are some of the features of consciousness so defined? Well, here, I could spend the whole lecture on this, but I'm just going to mention a small number of what I take to be the most important features. First of all, there's a remarkable feature of all conscious states, namely, there's something that it feels like to be in that state. So the enormous variety of conscious states you have, whether it's the taste of beer or the sound of music or feeling a stomach ache or pick your favorite, feeling the angst of post-industrial man under late capitalism. I have friends who think that I suffer from tremendous philistinism because I don't suffer the angst of post-industrial man under late. I got a lot of angst, but that's not one of them. Okay, anyway, all of those, there's something that it feels like. And then secondly, because of that, there is an ontological peculiarity to a consciousness. Ontology is just a big word. It means has to do with existence. But consciousness has a first-person mode of existence. It only exists insofar as it's experienced by some human or animal subject. And for that reason, it is, as I like to say, ontologically subjective. Now that immediately raises a problem because we've got another assorted tradition about subjectivity and objectivity, and those words are systematically ambiguous. There's an epistemic sense of those words that has to do with knowledge and an ontological sense that has to do with existence. In the epistemic sense, it's a matter of opinion. It's a subjective opinion that Van Gogh is a better painter than Gauguin. I think it's true, but I won't go to fight over it. I mean, it's a matter of opinion, but it's not a matter of opinion in that way that Van Gogh died in France. That's epistemically objective. But underlying that distinction is a distinction in modes of existence. And that is, some entities, like mountains and molecules and tectonic plates, have an objective ontology, an objective mode of existence. They exist regardless of whether they're experienced. Whereas pains and tickles and itches are ontologically subjective. They only exist insofar as they are experienced. Now, the reason that distinction is important for this discussion is that the ontological subjectivity of the domain does not prevent us from having an epistemically objective science of that domain. If there's one message I'd like to get across in this lecture, that's it. The subjectivity of the domain, the subjectivity of consciousness, is no obstacle to having an objective science of that domain. And that was the problem I had with the brainstabbers in San Francisco. Their argument went as follows. Science is objective, but on your own definition, consciousness is subjective, so there can be no science of consciousness. I hope you all recognize that as a textbook case of a fallacy of ambiguity. Objectivity and subjectivity are used with two different meanings. There is nothing about the ontologically subjective character of consciousness that prevents us from having an epistemically objective science of the domain of consciousness. And occasionally you read people who say, well, we couldn't ever get a real objective science of consciousness. Go to the neurology section of any university medical bookstore, and these doctors, they got real patients with real problems. No doctor says, well, we can't have a science of pain. There can't be a scientific account of pain. They want one. They want to know which kind of analgesics are going to work. Anyway, I'm digressing. We got two features of consciousness. It is qualitative, and qualitativeness implies subjectivity. But there's a third feature, and this feature is actually more important than most people realize, and that is all of our conscious states come to us as part of a single, united conscious field. That's a stunning fact. So I don't just hear the sound of my voice and feel the weight of my body against my shoes and see the people in the audience, but I have all of that as part of a single unified conscious field. Now this is one of the reasons for the failure of robotics. Nobody knows how to make a conscious robot that has anything like the stunning capacity for encompassing the environment that we get with a unified conscious field. It's not enough to use the information processing vocabulary. It isn't just that I get better information by having a unified conscious field, but I'm directly in contact with the environment, including my immediate past and my immediate present. Okay, so we got three features. My students like to take notes on crap like this, but anyway, here goes. Feature number one, it's qualitative. Two, it's subjective. And three, it's unified. Now, feature number four is also stunning, and that is it functions causally. See, there's always some philosopher that says, well, nothing as touchy-feely as consciousness could ever make a difference to the physical world. The current mantra is the physical world is causally closed. Well, you want to watch and see how consciousness makes a difference to the physical world. I decide to raise my arm and the damn thing goes up. And what's amazing, what is stunning, is I don't say, well, it's a bit like rain in Cambridge. Some days it goes up and some days it doesn't go up. No, it's entirely up to me. Now, how is that possible? Well, I have to answer that question. But now I want you to see it's a consequence of these four features. And this is the first, this is a really substantive or controversial claim that I'm going to make. Consciousness is irreducible and ineliminable. You can't get rid of it. See, a standard argument goes as follows. Look, there are a lot of folk psychological notions that we got rid of. The humors, for example, used to be, he's in a bad humor. There was a certain theory that underlay that turned out to be false. Well, why couldn't consciousness also be shown to be an illusion, like sunsets or rainbows? We now know the sun doesn't really set, and there isn't really an arch in the sky. Those are illusions. Why couldn't consciousness be an illusion? And the answer to that is rather important, and that's this. You can't show that consciousness is an illusion in the way that we show these other things to be illusion, because the illusion-reality distinction rests on how things consciously seem to us and how they really are. But where the very existence of consciousness is concerned, you can't make that distinction, because if it consciously seems to you that you are conscious, then you are conscious. I mean, think about it from a practical point of view. If a bunch of really heavy-duty, well-endowed scientists came to me and said, Searle, we have done a study of your brain, and we're absolutely convinced you're not conscious. There's no way you could be conscious given the crap you've got in your head. Now, at no point do I feel, well, you know, maybe these guys are right. I mean, they're all at major. I don't feel that, because where the very existence of consciousness is concerned, I can't be mistaken. Now, you can be mistaken about the details, about what conscious state you were in. You thought you were desperately in love, but she looked pretty good in that light, and you both had a lot to drink, and they were playing that goofy music that they play in Italy. Okay, so you can be mistaken about specific states, but about the very existence of conscious states, you cannot be mistaken. It's real and irreducible. Okay, well, there is a brief characterization of the character of consciousness. Now, why don't we just get busy and solve it as a scientific problem? And I want to suggest that is the right attitude to have, but I can't resist listing a series of mistakes that people make about consciousness, because these are pervasive. You can pick up the philosophy journals or look at recent books, and in one way or another, all of these mistakes are made. Well, the first mistake I've already attacked, and that's the one that says, well, it doesn't really exist. Consciousness is just part of folk psychology and has to go the rest of folk psychology. I've already attacked that, so I won't repeat it. But another one says, consciousness really does exist, but it couldn't make any difference to the physical world. It's epiphenomenal. That's the jargon that philosophers use. It's epiphenomenal. It's like the froth on the wave or the light that glints off of the lake when the sun hits it. It does not have any causal consequences. Now, I gave you this sort of folk psychological scientific demonstration, but how can that be? How can it be that something subjective, qualitative, and irreducible can physically move my arm? Now, the answer to that requires that we recognize that the same system will have different levels of description. In my car engine, the level of description at which I say there's an explosion in the cylinder that drives the piston, that's a different level from saying that there is an oxidization of hydrocarbons that releases heat energy. It's the same phenomenon described at different levels. Now, I want to show you how that works with raising your arm. I said, I form the intention to raise my arm. There's what I call an intention in action, in ordinary English, a trying, and my arm went up. How can that be? Well, that very event of my trying to raise my arm has a lower level of description, where among a whole lot of other things, it involves the secretion of a specific neurotransmitter, acetylcholine, at the axon end plates of the motor neurons. Now, that's not a trivial fact about this event, because no acetylcholine, no arm movement. It is the specific neurotransmitter for muscular movements. And in order that my intention to raise my arm should cause my arm to go up, there has to be a single unified phenomenon where it has a level of description, where it involves the secretion of acetylcholine, not just at the axon end plates, but in fact at every neural junction from the motor cortex on down. You have to have the right things going on in the plumbing, or the arm isn't going to go up. The important thing at this level of discussion is to see there's no mystery in principle how one and the same phenomenon, my conscious trying, my conscious intention to raise my arm, can cause a physical event in the world, my arm going up, because that phenomenon has different levels of description, and at a much lower level of description, it involves specific neurobiological processes which are essential to the movement of the arm. Now, I resist the temptation to go on about that because maybe it'll come up in the discussion, but this is a common mistake made in contemporary philosophy, is that people suppose if consciousness is really ontologically irreducible, then it couldn't function causally because, as they like to say, the physical world is causally closed. And what I'm suggesting here is that the vocabulary that makes a distinction between the mental and the physical, that says we're talking about two different ontological domains, that's our problem. There is a single event here that has different levels of description. And the biological level, the qualitative subjectivity of consciousness, that is just a biological feature like any other, like a photosynthesis or digestion or the secretion of bile or any other biological phenomena. And like biological phenomena in general, it has higher and lower levels of description. Okay, I'm going to take a drink of water. Now, I'm talking awfully fast, but how am I doing? It looks to me like everybody seems to be following me. Is this okay? Now, I'm embarrassed that we got so many nice people standing at the back. If you want to come and sit up in the front, as long as I can wander around a bit, I'll be happy. But it embarrasses me if people have to stand up when they could be more comfortable, or maybe less comfortable, on the floor. But in any case, you're welcome to move forward. Okay, I'm going to identify, just in effect for fun, a half a dozen of what I think are the most common mistakes that people make about consciousness, and I've identified two already. One is to say it doesn't exist, and that won't do. And the second is to say, well, it does exist, but it can't make any difference. That's epiphenomenalism, and I want to say that won't do either. Now, a third mistake, and this I think really is an embarrassment in our intellectual culture, is to say, well, consciousness really does exist, but it's something else. It's behavior. And it's stunning to think how influential behaviorism was for so long. And I think if you go back and look at those, Watson and other early behaviorists, they were driven by a reaction against the tradition of God, the soul, and immortality. That is, they thought if you grant the existence of consciousness, you're back in bed with Descartes. 300 years of scientific progress have been thrown out. And that's what I'm rejecting. I think the problem with behaviorism is it's self-refuting. If somebody says, well, your pain, that really just is your pain behavior. Well, we all know the difference between actually having a pain and engaging in pain behavior. If I were a good actor, I would now give you some pain behavior with no pain. You know, I'd clutch my stomach and double over in pain or whatever. But we all know the pain is one thing and the behavior is something else. And it ought to be an intellectual embarrassment that behaviorism was so influential for so long. You can always tell intellectual eras by the nomenclature that is inherited by institutional structures. At Stanford, there's a well-funded outfit called the Institute for the Study of the Behavioral Sciences. Nowadays, you couldn't call it that. You'd have to call it cognitive science. That's the current buzzword. And if you want to really get a research grant, the best buzzword today is cognitive neuroscience. So I just want to advise you next time you apply for a research grant, be sure to get in the right buzzwords. Behavior is no longer one of the buzzwords that you want to use. But cognitive and neuroscience are both very fashionable words. Okay. Well, another mistake along with behaviorism, and I won't spend much time on this, was the idea, yes, consciousness does exist, but it's really a computer program running in your brain, or maybe a whole bunch of computer programs. Well, I have actually attacked that at some length, and I'm embarrassed to say I first attacked it 34 years ago. And the debate still goes on, and I'm perfectly happy to debate it, but I'll be very brief. There's no way that consciousness could be identical with a computer program, because a computer program is defined formally or syntactically, typically in terms of zeros and ones, but any symbols will do. Could be Chinese symbols, for example, provided only they're formally or syntactically specifiable. To put this slightly more pretentiously, the notion same implemented computer program identifies a process not in virtue of its physical features, but in virtue of its formal or syntactical features, and we know independently that the syntax of the computer program isn't sufficient for the actual content, for the semantics of human consciousness and human thought processes. Form by itself doesn't give you content. And that's what I showed with that, with something called the Chinese room argument. And you would be surprised at the amount of stuff that was, do I have a thing I can write with, that was written about the Chinese room argument. In the early days, an argument against me went as follows. See, I don't know if you know this argument. The way it goes is this. My consciousness can't be a computer program because I can run the steps in the computer program for understanding Chinese and not understand Chinese. They give me these questions in Chinese. I look up in the program what I'm supposed to do. I give answers in Chinese. My answers pass the Turing test, but all the same, I don't understand a word of Chinese. And if I don't understand Chinese on the basis of implementing the Chinese understanding program, neither does it on any other digital computer on that basis, because no digital computer has anything I don't have. What it has is a program for carrying out the steps in an algorithm that implemented in various symbolic processes, and I can do that without understanding anything. Now, I gave an example of Chinese because I don't understand any Chinese, and as a result, I can imagine I give all these answers to questions in Chinese, but I still don't understand anything. Now, an answer that was given in response to me in the early days was this one. Suppose we ask you in Chinese, do you understand Chinese? And you say, yes, of course I understand Chinese. Well, wouldn't that show? Well, let's try it, okay? I get a symbol Now, this will be in a dialect of Chinese some of you may not recognize. I get a symbol in Chinese, and unknown to me, this symbol means, do you understand Chinese? Now, I don't know what the symbol means. I haven't a clue. But I look up in the computer rule book what I'm supposed to do, and it says, when you get that symbol, give them a symbol that looks like this. This is in that same dialect of Chinese that you may not recognize. Now, this second symbol means, why do you guys ask me such idiotic questions? Can't you see that I understand Chinese? Well, anyway, if anybody wants to raise the Chinese room in the discussion, but I won't say much more about it, there is a deeper argument that I want to mention briefly. I said there was a distinction between the epistemic and the ontological senses of the objective-subjective distinction. But using ontological subjectivity, we create a class of phenomena about which we can then make statements that are epistemically objective. I'm thinking of money and property and government and marriage. All of those are created by human consciousness, but their mode of existence is observer relative. It's relative to our interpretation that something is a sentence of English or a sentence of Chinese or a piece of money or a university or a cocktail party or what have you. All of those are observer relative phenomena. And as you know, you can make epistemically objective claims about observer relative phenomena, even though the phenomena all have an element of ontological subjectivity. Now, what about computation? Is that observer relative or is it absolute? And that is something that most people don't really care about when they write about theories of computation. But if you think about it, unless a conscious agent is actually carrying out a computation, you're adding 2 plus 2 to get 4, for example, that is observer independent. That's intrinsic. But if I write on the board, 2 plus 2 equals 4, there's nothing intrinsic about the marks that make them an implementation of the addition function. That's observer relative. Now, what about computation as such? Well, unless a conscious agent is actually going through the steps of a computer program, as I was in the Chinese room, or if I'm doing simple arithmetic, adding 2 plus 2 to get 4, if I'm implementing that in a piece of machinery, the computation in the machinery is entirely observer relative. Now notice that doesn't mean it's epistemically subjective because, of course, I pay a lot of money to have these computers. But computation does not name an intrinsic feature of nature. It names an interpretation that we can give to features of nature. Watch, I'll show you a simple computer. This thing just computed the function s equals 1/2 gt squared. It's a rather short s, I'm sorry to say. Because, well, that's the formula that describes the space that it fell in. That's the formula that describes how far it fell. Is this thing intrinsically computing? No, it's just gravity attracts it. And we have a way of attaching a computational interpretation of that. And I have pieces of hardware made by Apple Corporation south of San Francisco, and I paid a lot of money for them. But they no more do intrinsically computation than this thing is intrinsically a computer. Computation is observer relative. That doesn't mean statements about it are epistemically subjective, but it means that you can't discover computation in nature in a way that consciousness can be and is discovered in nature. That's actually a deeper argument than the Chinese room, but it didn't get nearly the attention that the other one did. Okay, well, I'm tempted to keep going on with these famous mistakes. We've listed several now. There's I didn't really attack dualism. I'm perfectly happy to attack it, but it is kind of giving up to say, well, we really, our biology could never make us conscious because consciousness is a property of the soul, and the soul is not a biological phenomenon. It is hard to realize what an extreme view Descartes held, and I'm not sure that it really is essential. It was picked up by the Christian theorists, by religious theorists, but I'm not sure that it really is essential. I have students who are Protestant theologians who tell me that my view is really consistent with a certain early form of Christian doctrine. I doubt if that's true, but anyway, that's what they tell me. But it's certainly not consistent with Descartes, because Descartes, you see, says, your body's not conscious, your brain is not conscious. The only thing that could be conscious is your soul, and the soul is temporarily attached to your brain. But when your body dies, the soul will leave the body because it died. Now, that is a revolutionary view. It's quite unlike the Greeks. You see, what the Greeks thought is the soul was a kind of life principle. It wouldn't make any sense to Aristotle. And forgive me, I don't really know any Aristotle, but this is what people tell me about Aristotle. It wouldn't make any sense to Aristotelian view to say first the body dies and then the soul leaves, because for the body to be alive is for it to be animated by the soul. That is a profoundly anti-Cartesian view. Descartes is more radical than people realize. Okay, well, look, now I've been doing a whole lot of polemical stuff, but let's shift gears and talk about neuroscience and how we might investigate this scientifically. Okay, so the next part's going to be not so argumentative. I'm going to talk about some neurobiological research. First, I have to stop and take a drink of water. It's kind of warm in here. I think I'm going to take my coat off. I hope it doesn't destroy the electronic apparatus that I'm attached to me. All right. I think there is a short answer to the question, what exactly is the relationship between consciousness in the brain? And I think that answer ought to motivate a research project by which we investigate the neurobiology of consciousness. Those of you who've had some philosophy will recognize this problem as the traditional mind-body problem. It's supposed to be a big deal, but I think philosophically it has a rather simple solution. Scientifically, it's much tougher for reasons I'll point out. Philosophically, here's the solution. All of our conscious states, without exception, are caused by lower level neurobiological processes in the brain. Most of the textbooks treat the neuron as the functional unit, but maybe that's wrong. Maybe it's below the level of the neuron, or maybe you've got to have whole clouds of neurons. But in any case, some neurobiological processes in the brain cause all of our states of consciousness, and that is a stunning fact, because all of those examples I gave you, whether it's tasting the water or feeling thirsty, listening to the music, worrying about income tax, all of your conscious states are caused by neurobiological processes in the brain. What then is their status? And the answer is, they are features of the neurobiological system at a higher level than the level of individual neurons. In a slogan, consciousness is caused by and realized in brain structures. It's the processes in the brain, we assume, described at the level of neurons, but possibly quite at much higher or lower levels. But when we identify the causes, what we've identified is the causes of a phenomenon which is realized in the brain. And these relations are not mysterious in nature. This stuff in my hand is in a liquid form. The liquid behavior is caused by the behavior of the H2O molecules. But the liquidity is not some extra thing squirted out by the molecules. It's the condition that the system is in. Now, in the same way, the consciousness of my brain is not something squirted out by the brain. It doesn't, so to speak, leak out in some mysterious fashion. It is the condition that the brain is in exactly the same sense that liquidity is the condition that this water is in. Okay, so there is a brief solution to the mind-body problem. All of our conscious states are caused by lower-level neurobiological processes, and they are realized in the neurobiological system in the same way that the solidity of the table or the liquidity of the water is realized in the system of molecules. So why is it so hard to figure out how it works? Well, I'm going to tell you what I think is the right way to approach this. I'm going to tell you some difficulties with approaching it. If you look at the history of science, there are typically three steps that something like this goes through. Step one, you find correlations. You find correlations between consciousness and certain processes in the brain. And there's a lot of research along those lines of identifying correlates of consciousness. It's even got a name now, and in the literature it's referred to as the NCC. And we have discovered given imaging techniques, you can discover various neural correlates of certain conscious processes. You can actually see in the brain where the processes are taking place. So step one, find a correlation. Step two, try to find out if the correlation is causal. And the usual methods here are, can you shut down the phenomenon by shutting down the correlation? And can you turn it on again by turning on the correlate? In an extreme case, could you take the brain from a conscious to an unconscious state by shutting down the NCC? And can you turn it on again by turning on the NCC? And then third, you would like to get a theory as to how it works. Now, as I said, this is not unusual in the history of science. Think of the discovery of the germ theory of disease. It starts with Semmelweis in Vienna. Semmelweis had an embarrassing situation where the women who went to the hospital to have their babies died much more often than the women who stayed home. They died of puerperal fever, and he figured out that this had something to do. He found a correlation. He found it had something to do with the fact that his young doctors never washed. They looked like they worked in a butcher shop. And he made them wash, and this, so he got a correlation. And then we know a whole lot of other steps necessary to get the germ theory of disease. Now, why don't we do that with consciousness? Why don't we just find the neuronal correlates and then find out how it actually produces consciousness? As I said, I think that's the right way to go, but I want to tell you some difficulties. If you look at the literature, and I had to do this some years ago because I was asked to write an article for the Annual Review of Neuroscience, and I did read a fair amount, not enough of course, but I did read a fair amount of the neurobiological research, and some of it is quite fascinating. A typical research line is to try to find cases where you have different conscious experiences with a constant outside stimulus. Why is that so important? The causation provided by the outside stimulus is constant. So if you can find the point in the brain where the brain, so to speak, decide to produce one experience rather than another, then you have discovered the NCC for that experience. An example that you will all recognize because it was made famous in Cambridge. Every time I draw a duck rabbit, it turns out looking even worse than earlier versions. Anyway, that's supposed to be a duck rabbit. Now again, it is a remarkable phenomenon. First of all, the stimulus is constant. But if you're at all good at this kind of stuff, you'll be able to see either a duck looking that way or a rabbit looking that way. Can everybody do this intellectual achievement? Okay, now notice an interesting thing. It doesn't look the least bit like a duck or a rabbit. If somebody brought you a duck that looked like that, you'd want your money back. I mean, it's just, it's hopeless. All the same, the brain has this remarkable capacity to take degenerate stimuli and construct them into meaningless holes. Now, meaningful holes. If you could find the point at which the brain goes from treating this as a duck to treating it as a rabbit, where constant stimulus produces a completely different experience, you would have found the NCC for that experience. And there are a lot of people who do research along just these lines. One of the best known is Logothetis and his group in Germany, and they study something called binocular rivalry. Now here's again a remarkable fact. If you show horizontal lines to one eye, you show vertical lines to one eye and horizontal lines to the other eye, the subject typically does not see a crosshatch. Typically, there's a competition and one side wins out. The horizontal lines win out or the vertical lines win out. This is called binocular rivalry. And if you could find the point where the brain makes up its mind, I speak metaphorically here, makes up its mind either to see the horizontal lines or to see the vertical lines, you would have found the NCC for that particular phenomenon. Another promising line of research is the work that Larry Weisskranz did in Oxford on blind sight. That's a question begging description, but I think you probably know the experiments, but let me just remind you how they work. You have patients who have damage to the brain, usually it's V1, and you have damage which is such that they're blind in a certain portion of the visual field. They really can't see anything there. So you tell the guy to focus his eye on the cross here, and you know that he's blind in the lower left quadrant, and then you very rapidly shine an X or an O in the lower left quadrant, too fast for him to shift his eyes. And you ask him, what did you see? And he says, I couldn't see anything. And typically the subjects get annoyed. You know, doctor, I was run over by a car when I was 10 years old. I can't see anything in that part. You say, well, make a guess. And the guys do make a guess. And they get it right 95% of the time. After a week of this, it's not a chance or randomness. After a week of this, their subject was getting it right 95% of the time. Now, what does that tell you? Well, it tells you there's some systems in the brain that are capable of getting visual information without consciousness. So it looks like, Weisskranz's original hypothesis was, well, there have to be at least two visual systems in the brain, only one of which is conscious because one of which is not conscious. This is clearly taking in visual information, but not conscious. And there's a whole lot of further research along this. There are two guys in Canada. What are their names? Jennifer, do you remember the... it'll come back to me, but in any case, Milner and Goodale, right. I have my colleague here, and she's an expert. Milner and Goodale did a whole lot of research, and they identified more than two visual pathways in the brain. Anyway, it looks like if you could figure out exactly the difference between the conscious pathway that gives you the conscious information and the unconscious pathway that gives you the information unconsciously, it looks like you would have the NCC for consciousness. Okay, now I could go on with this with a whole lot of other cases, but there's a sense in which, though we've been doing this for a number of years now, the results are disappointing. We have the NCCs for quite interesting specific forms of consciousness, and a friend of mine actually who does research on this at UCSF has found where in the brain people solve certain problems, where they solve the Tower of Hanoi problem. And she finds interesting differences between the way women solve this in their brain and the way men solve it in their brains. It's just a different neurophysiological structure that is in use here. And it looks like, well, we're now finding all these NCCs. Why don't we now have a theory of consciousness? And I want to suggest there's something wrong with all this research. And that is, it's all done on subjects that are already conscious. Remember, I told you that all of our consciousness occurs as part of a unified conscious field. So it's given the unified conscious field that the guy either has or does not have a conscious awareness of the X and the O. But what we would really like to know is, how does the brain create the unified conscious field in the first place? How is it that the brain is able to create the conscious field? The standard view in the literature is this. We should think of perception as creating consciousness. I think that's a mistake. Of course, there's a sense in which perception creates consciousness, because if I see something, I have a form of consciousness which I didn't have before. But I want to suggest the right way to think of it is to think of perception as modifying a pre-existing conscious field. Imagine you wake up in a completely dark room, in a strange place, as I've been doing every morning now. You wake up in a dark room in a strange place. Your first feeling is, what the hell am I doing here? But then you kind of figure it out. Okay, now you get up and get dressed and brush your teeth and so on and move about. Are you creating consciousness? Well, in a sense, you are, because you create forms of consciousness that were not there before. But I want to suggest the right way to think of this is perception doesn't create consciousness, it modifies the unified conscious field. And what we would like to know is, how does the brain create the unified conscious field in the first place? In other words, it seems to me there are two research approaches. There's one that has worked very well in the history. This is not a speech act. Tim is not demonstrating his disapproval. He's actually got to make a train. There are two different research approaches. One research approach is what I call the building block approach, and that is you think of the conscious field as made up of all the building blocks of specific percepts. So the red of the scarf and the blue of the dress, all of those are these atomistic units that are put as building blocks into the unified conscious field. But there is another approach that says, no, start with the unified conscious field and ask, how does the brain create the unified conscious field? And I think that the disappointments we've been having are that the research methods that have proved so useful to us are not really suited to identifying such a large global phenomenon as the unified conscious field. The research methods that are standardly used are either you do single cell recordings, you find a neuron that fires in response to certain stimuli, or they're imaging techniques like PET scans and CAT scans, and most famously now MRI, fMRI is the favorite research. And I admire this stuff enormously. I think it's wonderful that we've got this. But neither of those is really suited to examining the whole operation of big chunks of the brain, which is what we need to figure out if we're going to figure out how the brain creates the unified conscious field. So the upshot is progress is slow. Now there's another depressing result, and that is, well, maybe there's nothing wrong with research techniques. Maybe there's something wrong with my theory that says the brain creates consciousness by a set of causal processes and it's a biological phenomenon like any other. I think it's going to be a long time before I'm willing to give up on that, because the alternative seemed to me to be really unacceptable, to say, well, the brain is not a part of, the consciousness is not a part of nature, and you can't figure out how it works in the brain. No, we know too much about how the brain works and about how consciousness exists as a biological phenomenon of certain sorts of humans and other animals. By the way, there's always some philosopher who will tell you animals aren't conscious. I have had a sequence of dogs of stunning intelligence, all of whom are famous for their consciousness. Their names are Frege, Russell, Ludwig, and now Tarski. And there's just no, I mean, I'm sorry I couldn't bring Tarski along. He's a Bernese mountain dog. So there's no question that animals are conscious. We don't know how far down the phylogenetic scale consciousness goes. Okay, so Tarski's conscious. How about fleas? Are they conscious? I don't know. I'll leave that to experts, and it'll be a long time before the experts are able to tell us. But in any case, we start with a fact that consciousness is a real phenomenon, and it's irreducible. It's entirely caused by neurobiological processes, and it exists in the brain as higher level or system features. I can't reach in my brain and say this neuron is thinking about its grandmother any more than I can reach in a glass of water and say this one's wet, and I'll see if I can find you a dry one. I can't pick out a wet molecule or a dry molecule. Wetness and liquidity don't exist at the level of individual molecules, and consciousness does not exist at the level of individual neurons. Okay, so where are we? Well, I would like to say there is a kind of unified scientific project to try to discover the character of consciousness, but there's still just an awful lot of, I think, intellectual confusion out there of the kind that I was trying to identify earlier. So I just came from they have this biennial event in the desert, consciousness in the desert. Now, in most philosophy conferences, you attract a relatively sane collection of people. But if you decide you're going to have a large international conference on consciousness and you hold it in the middle of the desert, under the desert stars and so on, well, you get some very strange papers. You get some very strange productions there. And I won't I've spoken long enough already. I won't tell you some of the most outrageous views about consciousness, but I think the ones that have a lot of influence that seem to me false to the point of being pernicious to the extent that they actually discourage fruitful research are the ones that I've identified. The idea that, well, really it's just behavior, or the idea that, well, really it's just a computer program or set of computer programs, or the idea that, well, it couldn't make any real causal difference to the world because it's too touchy-feely to have any physical effect. I would like to militate against those and try to leave you with a message that this is, I think, the most exciting field of investigation in the biological sciences today. And truth to tell, I think it's the most exciting field of investigation in the sciences. Now, I have to confess, I'm let down again by those guys. I've been telling my students literally for decades that the world consists of entities we find it convenient, perhaps not entirely accurate, to call particles. Okay, and they're organized into systems, and we have a quantum mechanical explanation of the chemical bond. I love all that kind of stuff. But it turns out that's 4% of the world. What's the other 96%? Dark matter and dark energy. What's dark about it? It's our epistemology that's dark. We don't know what the hell is going on. Now, you know, I have friends up on the hill. It's a different hill. They have a similar thing in Cambridge. But they get paid a lot of money to do physics. And they ought to at least to tell me more than just about the 4%. Okay, anyway, so that's, we got 4%, and we're pretty confident about that. Now, are we the only conscious planet? Is our little suburban planet, is it the only locus of consciousness in the universe? It seems very unlikely. Think about it. In this 4%, in our galaxy, there are 100 billion stars in the same line of business as our sun. They don't all have planets like ours do, but certainly a fair number are going to have planets. 100 billion. How many galaxies are there? There are 100 billion galaxies. And those two facts only describe, remember, 4% of the known universe. So whatever is producing consciousness on our little Earth, it's very likely that there are all sorts of other forms of consciousness, other locus of consciousness. And they may, for all we know, use a different kind of biochemistry, the one we use. I've never fully understood our obsession with carbon-based molecules with lots of hydrogen, nitrogen, and oxygen. Why do we have this fetish for this? And my friends who do this stuff professionally tell me you couldn't do it with silicon. It's not accidental that we have carbon-based molecules. You've got to have this kind of stuff. I'm not sure they've convinced me, but in any case, they make a strong case. Anyway, I want to leave you with a thought that this is an exciting area of scientific investigation, and who knows, this is Cambridge. Maybe somebody here is going to solve the problem of consciousness. Thank you very much.